the prologue of the wisdom of Jesus, the son of Sirach. Whereas many and great things have been delivered unto us by the law and the prophets, and by others that have followed their steps, for the which things Israel ought to be commended for learning and wisdom, and whereof not only the readers must needs become skillful themselves, but also they that desire to learn be able to profit them which are without, both by speaking and writing. My grandfather, Jesus, when he had much given himself to the reading of the law and the prophets and other books of our fathers, and had gotten therein good judgment, was drawn on also himself to write something pertaining to learning and wisdom, to the intent that those which are desirous to learn, and are addicted to these things, might profit much more in living according to the law. Wherefore, let me entreat you to read it with favor and attention, and to pardon us, wherein we may seem to come short of some words, which we have labored to interpret. For the same things uttered in Hebrew, and translated into another tongue, have not the same force in them. And not only these things, but the law itself and the prophets, and the rest of the books, have no small difference when they are spoken in their own language.
Kal halal Yahweh Bashim Yashai Bashim Rakakudash. Double honors unto the apostles and elders of Great Millstone who do rule well. Shabbat shalom to you of us who are hopeful. Shabbat shalom to the elect. Now, let me premise this quick exhortation with this. Nehemiah, the 13th chapter. We're going to verse 23. Nehemiah 13 and 23. Because it says this. In those days also saw I Jews that had married wives of Ashdod, which I believe at that time spoke to the Philistines, i.e. The Canaanites, who were the children of Ham, of course, not the bastards of Ashdod, a.k.a. Amalek, that lives there today, who of Ammon, speaking to present-day Japanese, and of Moab, which speaks to the so-called Chinese. And their children spake half in the speech of Ashdod. Now, being an extension of Canaan, there may be some confusion based on the assumption the Philistine children already spoke the language of Canaan, which we know is the Paleo Hebrew. Paleo meaning original, speaking to the ancient Hebrew and what we call today the Lashawan Kodash. Kodash meaning holy, holy meaning pure and set apart, Lashawan meaning tongue or language. But no, at that time it is said that the language of the Philistines resembled that of the Egyptians, or that they used a dialect with different words and an accent that the Israelites of that time wouldn't have recognized, okay? And could not speak in the Jews' language. The Jews' language meaning the same language that Judah spoke during Hezekiah's rulership, the Lashon Kodash, the Hebrew, but according to the language of each people. Ergo, the offspring of Israel were speaking a mixed dialect of half Ashdodite and half Hebrew, a varied dialect of Ammon and Moab, which in origin, of course, was Shemitic, but regarded as, again, foreign tongues to Israel. And I contended with them, and this is the point here, and cursed them and smote certain of them and plucked off their hair and made them swear by saying, ye shall not give your daughters unto their sons nor take their daughters unto your sons or for yourselves. Now, I know it wasn't only about the mutt language being spoken, it was also the manners and principles taken on by the children that had Nehemiah upset. But the reason why I brought this out, if you were paying attention to the opening clip, is the importance of the Israelites rehearsing the righteous acts, which includes going into the Hebrew. Now, I was doing some research and came across this book that referenced this same account, and I wanted to pull some excerpts that speaks to every and anybody who scoffs at reacquainting ourselves with our father tongue, okay? One excerpt I came across was the matter concerning Baal. And it says this, the names of Baal is the heading. This particular connection shines through in an interesting observation with regards to the use of the name Baal. The word Baal, which means in the Hebrew, husband, master, was also used to designate the Hebrew God in the spiritual context of the conjugal covenant, where God, here they have the tetragrammaton, which we don't subscribe to. The Heavenly Father's name is Yahweh, which means he exists. He is the all in all and everything. His son's name is Yahweh Shai, which means he saves, he delivers. His name is not Jesus, okay? The word Baal, which means in Hebrew husband, master, was also used to designate the Hebrew God in the spiritual context of the conjugal covenant, where the power, Yahweh, is the husband and Israel, the wife. Yet under the Phoenician, which is simply the Greek for saying Canaanite influence, Israel began to confuse her god, the master, the husband, Baal, and Baal, the Phoenician god of fertility. Okay, it is noteworthy that prophets like Amos and Hosea felt the need to react against that confusion on the level of the language. Although Amos knew the conjugal metaphor, and Amos 3 and 2, Amos 4 and 12, Amos 5 and 2 is being cited here, he never used the term Baal. Now, for those of you at home and in the circumference of my voice, you can research this if you like. Likewise, Hosea 2 and 16 is cited here, warned his people, "And it shall be in that day, says the Lord, that you will call me my husband, Ishi, my man, and no longer call me my master, Bali, my Baal." On the other hand, names which contain the element of Baal are often changed, and the word Baal is replaced by the word Bashet, meaning shame. This is the case for Jerubasheth instead of Jerubbaal. 2 Samuel 11 to 21 is cited there. This phenomenon is particularly telling, and here's the point here, in that it shows how aware the Israelites were of the influence of language upon the mind, hence upon religious decision, okay? Which goes back to the opening clip, which was the reading of the prologue of the wisdom of there they said Jesus. We know that to properly mean, properly speak to Hawashai, son of Sirach. The books of the Apocrypha were, of course, written originally in the Hebrew and Aramaic, sometimes referred to as Chaldee. And as far as I know, the original text didn't survive. My educated guess is they were suppressed and somewhere hidden in the Vatican's library and not set afire to, as they would have you believe. But who's to say? Eventually all will be revealed, so saith Yahweh. Today what we got is the Greek and Latin translations, which leads us to another excerpt by Paul. But the gist of the point I'm getting to is, if it's not the Lashawan Kodash, the ancient Hebrew, there is something special that gets lost in the translation. Okay. The other excerpt I want to pull is for those of you who refute Hebrew as the father of them all, in reference to all languages, and especially the language of present-day Babylon, and speaking to Esau's system of rule, Esau's system of control, as well as how Esau's system of privilege, as well as how easy it is to learn with the correct practice. And I'm speaking again to the Lashon Kodash, the Paleo Hebrew. And no, I'm not fluent, but I'm striving for perfection, as you should. Okay, now listen to this. It says, a Hebrew is one of the easiest languages of the world in comparison to other ancient languages contemporary to the biblical times, such as Sumerian, Akkadian, or even to Greek, or to any modern language. Hebrew displays a more simple grammar and vocabulary. There are no declensions to learn, and again, look that up for those of you at home. In opposition to Sumerian, Akkadian, Greek, German, etc., there is very little vocabulary. Only about 225 words are used more than 200 times in the Bible. They constitute the basic vocabulary. The remaining words are either made up of etymological related words, say that five times fast, or are rare words. Also, many words have entered our own vocabulary. Alleluia, Hosanna, Amen, and Rabbi, etc. Some display even a common etymology, Ayan, which is the I. German Agen and French Iel, Salakia, etc., etc. In the same way, the grammatical structure is familiar to us, as it is basically made of the same elements, nouns, prepositions, adjectives, verbs, sentences, etc. The fundamentals of grammar can be apprehended in 15 hours. The main obstacle which confronts the student is the deciphering of the Hebrew signs. Now hear this, because we get this pushback a lot when we tell you where these languages of present-day use in Esau society come from. Actually, the ancient Hebrew alphabet is the father of our Latin alphabet via Phoenician and Greek, and the reading of the letters can be mastered in 5 hours of good practice. Jumping back a little bit, it also says this. The Hebrew tongue is altogether despised because of impiety. Now, impiety meaning a lack of reverence, a lack of respect for its power and its importance in layman's terms. Or perhaps because people despair of learning it. Without this language, there can be no understanding of the scriptures. Let me say that again. Without this language, there can be no understanding of the scriptures. For the New Testament, although written in Greek, is full of Hebraisms. It is rightly said that the Hebrews drink from the fountains, i.e. of living water. That's me quoting Jeremiah 2 and 13. The Greeks from the streams, and the Latins from the pools. Now remember, Esau's rulership is just a reincarnation of old rulerships. So to get ahead or claim your seat at the higher echelons of society, so to speak, you have to have a working knowledge of Latin and the Greek to unlock certain keys. If you don't know Latin, it's hard to entertain being a lawyer. That's one instance. And if you're not well versed in the Greek, the chances of you obtaining your doctorate to practice medicine is nil and next to none. There's one more excerpt I want to pull, actually two. And believe me, there's a plethora of precepts and verses that can be cited and quoted here, but I want to stay on topic, and that is, again, the importance of the tongue, the father tongue of Hebrew. And so regarding this book, this is if you ask me if I recommend it, to be honest, that's an emphatic no, at least not past the introduction, unless you're trying to learn Yiddish, which, is the knockoff Hebrew, if you will, and the use of those Masoretic dots that Elder Yeremia and I love so much. Double honors to the Elder. Prayers up, as always. Now, I want to bring out this excerpt because it goes into what we've been trying to tell you, so-called Christians, all along, and how important the Hebrew is in understanding what is written of in the scriptures, if you haven't gathered that already. Matter of fact, there's several passages in the book that speaks to you directly. Here's one with the heading, Hebrew is not a Christian language. And it says this: this statement will rarely be pronounced nowadays as it was in the past, especially during the Middle Ages. This opinion betrays clear anti-Semitic biases and is derived from the old Marcionite heresy that opposed the Old Testament to the New Testament and deemed the former as being inferior to the latter. In fact, Hebrew was the first language of the Christians and the language of their holy writings. We always tell y'all that the real Christians were the Hebrew Israelites anyways. In any event, it says this: it is for that matter a part of the Christian heritage, not only because of the Old Testament, but also because of the New Testament. Absolutely, as the scriptures tell us, Yahushua comes in the volume of the book. Now listen to this. If the Christian is seeking a Christian truth apart from Hebrew, he will discover a truth that is not biblical and therefore not Christian. I mean, what do you say to that? To be very honest, what comes to mind is Matthew 13 and 11. Let's get that before we close out. Okay, because it says this: and the disciples came and said unto him, and to him is our deliverer, Yahushua, why speakest thou unto them in parables? He answered and said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. Something we always go into is, in order to discover the mysteries, never mind the understanding of secular history and how it relates to the life and times written of in the Bible and the prophecies, you gotta go into the Hebrew and into the Greek in order to master this truth. These are the parables to those outside of it, okay? For those of you who subscribe to Being a Seventh-day Adventist, the so-called reformer Ellen G. White was adamant about how important the Hebrew is. She called it the most sacred tongue in the world. So let's close with this, Isaiah 19 and 18. And if you want a crash course in the Hebrew, there are still lessons of the elder apostles of Great Millstone, of GMS, getting down all over the internet. In post, I'll put up the correct alphabet as we know it through the Spirit for those of you inspired, okay? Isaiah 19 and 18 says this: in that day shall five cities in the land of Egypt speak the language of Canaan and swear to the Lord Yahweh of hosts. One shall be called the city of destruction. Again, the language of Canaan is the Paleo Hebrew, the ancient Hebrew language, what we call today the Lashon Kodesh. We Hebrew Israelites fulfilled this prophecy, starting with the apostles and elders who do rule well on down. It's not about being fluent. I can't stress that enough. And it does not matter that we haven't perfected it, but an important thing to realize is that you can't commit to Acts 4 and 12, per se, without it. Speaking to a major key to salvation, and that's speaking to knowing and calling on the name of the Heavenly Father and His Son, right? The city of destruction is America, aka Babylon, the great land of confusion, where we first lost our identity, the name of our power in God, and the tongue of our forefathers. Something I forgot to go into, which is of equal importance, is where the name of Hebrew stems and how it came into fruition. Let's go to Joshua 24:14, because it says this: "And put away the gods which your father served on the other side of the flood," speaking to the idols of the Chaldees before Heber. Eber meaning the region beyond or crossed over. Properly, Ibar is where Ibarium or Hebrew comes from. If you know the biblical history, I'll leave it to you, for those of you who like to research and are doing the your due diligence at home, to locate the first sighting of the name Eber in the scriptures. So not only did our forefather survive the flood of idolatry, he survived the confusion of languages, speaking to Hebrew being the original language spoken, as Peleg, the name of his son, means division. Just a small historical tidbit to help you remember again the importance of the Hebrew. Zephaniah 3:9, let's go there. And it says this: "For then will I turn to the people a pure language, that they may all call upon the name of Yahweh," and you're witnessing that now, "to serve him with one consent." Again, speaking of the Lashon Kodash, the holy tongue, and us coming back into the understanding of it in these times now. In going to the Hebrew, what we're really doing is this, and this is Judges 5:11, and it reads: "They that are delivered," speaking to the election of Israel, "from the noise of archers," meaning the nations who have nuclear missiles, i.e. the great noise that is made by the missiles when they are fired. And you know, we all can bear witness to the wars and rumors of wars that are erupting around the earth. "In the places of drawing water," speaking to Jake's captivity in present day Babylon, the great, historically, the transatlantic slave trade comes to mind. "There shall they rehearse the righteous acts of Yahweh Ba'ashem Yahweh Shai," speaking to the laws, the statutes, and the commandments, and coming back into the remembrance, revisiting the old ways, the old paths. Jeremiah 6:16 is a precept there. Only the two-thirds of Israel will refuse to go back to those old paths. "Even the righteous acts toward the inhabitants of his villages in Israel, then shall the people of the Lord power Yahweh go down to the gates." Call halal Yahweh Ba'ashem Yahushai Ba'ashem Rakak Wadash through the power and spirit. I hope you're edified. Double honors unto the apostles and elders of Great Millstone, who teaches 100% truth and rule well. Salutations to the hopeful elect. Remember, no tests, no yab, and damn sure don't take that C. To the H, to the A, to the P. Shalom Yasharallah. Shalom to the elect.